History proclaims Napoleon as one of the greatest generals in the annals of warfare. His strategic vision, timing, and his consummate grasp of every one of the myriad details which together influence the behavior of a vast army have made him a legendary figure to rank alongside Alexander the Great, Caesar, and Hannibal. The conclusive proof of this military genius was furnished for all time on the slopes of the frozen heights of Pratzen on the 2nd of December, 1805. As the famous blood-red sun of Austerlitz rose through the mist on the morning of this his greatest battle, Napoleon was confident of victory. But even he could not have forecast just how complete his triumph would be. Napoleon was crowned Emperor of France by his own hand in a ceremony of great pomp and circumstance on the 2nd of December, 1804. His moment of supreme glory came after a rapid series of promotions, which had seen him move from a little-known captain of artillery to undisputed master of France in only 6 years. His rise to these dizzy heights had not been without its troubles, however. The new emperor, basking in the adoration of his people, had to fight hard to protect the ideals of the revolution which had put him there. Napoleon had spent almost the whole of the last 11 years at war against various combinations of the forces of Britain, Austria, Prussia, Russia, Holland, and Italy. So inured to warfare had he become, that he accepted that to fight constantly would become an integral part of his life and that of his country. Between old monarchies and a young republic, a spirit of hostility must always exist. In the present state of affairs, every peace treaty means no more than a brief armistice. And I believe that my destiny will be to fight almost continuously. To fight almost continuously was indeed to become the lot of Napoleon Bonaparte. His implacable enemy was, as always, England, a nation which Napoleon detested with a passion. The English armies and navies had proved a constant thorn in the side of Napoleon, and his most spectacular defeats then, as later, were at the hands of the British. Memories of the disastrous naval battle of the Nile and Alexandria on land still haunted Napoleon. His anger was kindled anew when Britain was instrumental in bringing together a new coalition. This new coalition, formed from Austria, Russia, and Britain, was pledged to destroy forever the destabilizing influence which a young revolutionary nation like France was thought to have on the old order. France was seen as a massive threat to the trade and influence of the old established monarchies, who thrived on the status quo. Napoleon was therefore caricatured as an ogre and a man of blood. This was not the first coalition to be brought into play against the French. There had been two others in the recent past whose actions had produced rather mixed results. At this time, however, the Allies felt sure that the overwhelming numbers which they could bring to bear against the French armies would ensure the complete destruction of the upstart General Bonaparte forever. The hopes of the coalition were further bolstered by the intelligence that Prussia, who had been vacillating between actively joining the coalition and acting as a mediator for peace, was now more than likely to join the other nations in arms against Napoleon. This would bring a huge influx of men against the emperor, and with hindsight, this could well have made the situation untenable for him. In the early months of 1805, The strategic situation therefore looked very promising indeed for the nations of the Third Coalition.
What the enemy couldn't know, the Allies couldn't know, was the sheer quality of this new Napoleonic army. Since 1800, France had been largely at peace, and Napoleon completely restructured his military machine. And this is what's going to be really put to test here in the campaign of 1805.
As always, Napoleon was obsessed with the idea of invading England. Since 1803, his armies had been concentrated in the two huge military camps at Boulogne, where the men were poised to launch an invasion across the Channel. During the long wait, these camps had become so well established that the men actually had time to cultivate gardens and construct a makeshift town of wooden huts. Napoleon used these camps as a site for training maneuvers and for the celebrated distribution of the Crosses of the Legion of Honor in 1804. Medals and parades, however, were the only martial purpose to which the camps would be put, as long as control of the high seas rested with the British Navy. The army could not be transported while the British controlled the seas. The British Navy, however, held the French Navy in contempt and kept the French fleets bottled up in port. A deadlock which the outclassed French Navy never looked like breaking. Despite the increasingly rude taunts from the Emperor to his admirals, the French Navy steadfastly failed to put to sea. So while the French army idled away the time, awaiting a naval breakthrough, the thoughts of the Emperor were assumed to be wholly bent on his planned invasion of England. This was the weakness which the Allies sought to exploit in the coming campaign of 1805. Together, the three major players of the Third Coalition had created a grandiose master plan of great strategic vision, but one which ultimately overlooked some very real practical considerations. A series of four great offensives, each in a different part of Europe, were planned to be launched simultaneously. In the north, a British force, aided by Swedish and Russian elements, would attack Napoleon's ally, the Kingdom of Denmark, with a view towards bringing Hanover back under the sway of the British crown. It was also hoped that the presence of such a large allied force, nearly 100,000 men, so near his borders, would further help to persuade the King of Prussia to join the coalition. The next French ally to be subject to simultaneous attack was to be Bavaria. She was to be invaded by the Austrian general Mack with 85,000 men. Marching to his aid were a further 85,000 Russians under Kutuzov. Once joined, the forces would seize Ulm and then strike against Strasbourg. Archduke Charles, with 100,000 of the best Austrian troops available to him, was to strike into northern Italy and expel the French from Lombardy before moving on to invade the south of France. A poise between Mack's force, pressing on to Ulm, and Archduke Charles' forces in Italy, was the Austrian Archduke John, with a further 25,000 Austrians. They were ready to support the armies in either Germany or Italy, depending on how the situation developed. The final arm of this great master plan was a combined Russian and British force from Malta, which was to be augmented by 36,000 exiled Bourbon troops from Sicily, who were to reconquer Naples from the French, then strike northwards to join Archduke Charles in the invasion of southern France.
If there's one word with which to describe the Allied grand strategy for the campaign of 1805, I feel that word must be grandiose. Now, it looks superb on a map, great broad arrows, four of them, four different offensives to be mounted together against various parts of the French area of influence and so forth. But how the Allies hoped to coordinate those four great offensives, as was necessary for them to have their full effect, the Lord only knows.
If the plan was brilliant in its conception, it was to prove disastrous in its execution. The two theatres to the extreme north and south involving British troops failed to blossom into any real strategic danger, and the real victories were confined as usual to the British Navy, who continued to triumph with monotonous regularity in almost every action fought between the ships of the two countries. The problems of communication meant that the drive into Hanover under Bennigsen was very slow to develop. Consequently, only the Austrian armies operating against Bavaria under General Mack were operational by September. They were expected to be reinforced very soon by Kutuzov with his 85,000 men marching from Russia. It was here that the grand strategy of the Allies would begin to fall apart. Unbeknown to the Austrian chiefs of staff, the Russians were actually using the old-style Russian calendar, a different calendar from their allies. This calendar used a system of dating which was 12 days later from the one used by the rest of Europe. The armies of the period still relied on horses for transport, and the infantry had to march on foot over the huge distances involved. It took literally months to concentrate the armies and march from Russia to Europe, and it was the failure to synchronize the months which was to have catastrophic consequences for the Allies.
In the early 19th century, the difference between the two calendars, the old and the new,